Okay, Adam, it's Stanley Nelson. It's good to be on the show. Thanks so much for doing this.
Oh, my pleasure. I think I've seen at least a couple of your films at the Maryland Film Festival because I go every year, and that's where I saw Miles Davis' Birth of the Cool. I really enjoyed it. I was looking around for you, but I didn't run into you there.
Oh, I was there. Excuse me. They may have showed it twice, but I was there for the first showing. I was there. It was a great, great showing.
Yeah, it was one of those whirlwind things probably where you were also in and out pretty quick, so... But this makes much more sense to do it now, just on the cusp of the film coming out, right? What day is it coming out again?
Friday the 25th. This Friday,
At Film Forum.
Yep.
Which is terrific.
Yeah, we're really excited. The Black Panthers, Vanguard, the Revolution played there, and we did really well starting out there with it. So we're really excited about presenting Miles there, and they were great partners. So we're looking forward to it.
So there's been so much said about Miles Davis over the years. You know, he's like one of those icons now. And when you get that icon status, there's so much information and misinformation. And it seems as though what you're trying to do is cut through that.
I think that you know, we were really surprised that there really wasn't a good film biography of Miles, you know. In some ways for most people, you know, we're breaking new ground. I mean, one of the tricks with any kind of documentary film like this about an icon or about, you know, the Panthers who are very iconic, you know, is that there's some people who feel like they know a lot, and there's some people who go in not knowing anything. So, you know, how do you kind of bridge that gap? How do you make a film that's interesting for everybody?
But people are prone to myth making, and it's, imagine to make him just a human being who had maybe spectacular talents, but he's still a human being, flawed and beautiful the way all human beings are. But that seems to be the idea of making a biography like this, is where you want him to show that he was the man and not just an icon.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the great things about making a film about Miles Davis is, you know, he's so complicated, you know, and that only makes it, more rich, you know, a much richer film to be able to make a film about somebody who's so complicated and who kind of leaked into so many different arenas, you know. It's not only music and music in, you know, five or six different decades, but also, you know, the iconic character, you know, the dressing, the cars, the, you know, race all come into it. So there's so much there that makes Miles just such an interesting character.
Obviously, at the end of the day, he becomes a political figure just being who he is for many people. But was he political in his own intentions?
I mean, I think he was both. And you know, I think there was obviously some reactionary things that you see in the film. But I think also, you know, Miles was, kind of ahead of his time in being a leader politically in a kind of a strange way, because Miles looked at it as, it's all a political statement, the way he dressed, you know, the fact that he, you know, wanted the best of everything, that, you know, that he deserved it. And so I think that makes him very political. And he came to represent this kind of new black man, you know, that emerged in the 60s, you know, as someone says in the film, you know, he's kind of a black man who takes no shit, you know, and that was something new, you know, that was something that we didn't see in the 50s.
What do you do when you're making a documentary like somebody who's relatively recent person in our culture, but where maybe it's just a bit far back where most of his contemporaries have died? There's a couple of people I know, a number of his colleagues, including, of course, Wayne Shorter and some of the other musicians you had in the film. Oh, my gosh.
Jimmy Cobb and all those guys.
A number of them also obviously have passed away in the last 10 years or so. And so what do you do around that in order to get firsthand accounts of Miles?
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting point, and it's something, you know, I've run into in other projects. I think you know, what it means is that in some ways, you know, you have to search a lot harder for people who might have played with him or known him in the 40s, and the 50s. And then as you get to the 60s, as you get to the second quintet with Herbie Hancock and Wayne Shorter.
Herbie, that's right.
And Ron Carter, you know, there's more more people who work with him. And then as you get to the 70s, you know, there's tons of people around. So and then you have more to pick and choose. But I think what one of the things that we do, I think successfully in the film, is it doesn't seem like there's nobody there from the 40s or the 50s. And there's a lot of people there from the 70s. We were able to find, you know, people who knew him actually as a teenager in East St. Louis. And that was just amazing.
And then there is Archive, which was around from the beginning, you know, which is just amazing. This incredible archive and the responses to this new type of music. It's really fun to watch that, you know, like when Walter Cronkite talks about this new crazy sound of that the kids are listening to. Doesn't that sound familiar?
Yeah. That was just a great find, and we were able to use it. But, you know, also, you know, we found great archive. You know, his friend Corky McCoy had a 60mm camera and you know, filmed Miles, you know, boxing and some other stuff that nobody had ever seen.
A lot of home movies.
Yeah, Corky actually had these home movies in his basement, you know, and we were able to get that footage and restore it and it's just, it's beautiful. Nobody, I mean, he literally had, you know, 16mm rolls in his basement that we were able to find and use, which was great. But, you know, also, you know, from the time, you know, in the mid-50s when Miles signs with Columbia, you know, they had photographers, you know, with him, you know, in the studios, you know, so they're filming, they're shooting the whole Kind of Blue sessions, all those sessions, they have photographers filming it. So there's great, great photography, and we were able to work a deal with Sony to use all that stuff.
I was at Sony for years, and I remember going in the vault of just being able to see the original masters, by the way, of Miles Davis, and just being touching the spines to say that I had that experience.
That's great. Right. I mean, one of the other things that we were able to use was the kind of crosstalk in the studio. Because one of the things that Miles did, you know, from the very beginning at Columbia was just kind of keep the tape rolling, you know. He would just keep the tape rolling so they wouldn't just, you know, start when the song started. They would keep the tapes rolling. And you could hear the crosstalk of them kind of creating these songs, you know, right there in the studio. And so that was just beautiful to be able to use the crosstalk. And if you see the film in theaters and you see it in 5.1, the audio 5.1, you know, then you know, we did the crosstalk, so it's coming from all over the room, you know, just like you're in a studio and you know, different people are in different parts of the studio. So that's kind of fun to hear.
I think a very moving moment in the documentary, again, it's called Miles Davis, Birth of the Cool, directed by Stanley Nelson, which is having its theatrical premiere at Film Forum on August 23rd. One of the more moving moments I thought was, and I'm going to screw up which musician said this, I think it was Herbie Hancock, but he, correct me if I'm wrong, but he said that Miles Davis would, you know, where you really see the intensity and the beauty of the man was when he would play the ballads, you know, because especially in front of audiences, it's great to showboat and show all you can do and show off like that. But, you know, when you're playing a ballad, a slow tune, and you have to play it and connect with audiences and move them, that's when you see really where the genius and the beauty of this musician is.
Yeah, that's actually one of my favorite sections in the film, and you know, that is Herbie Hancock talks about, and Carlos Santana and others. And
oh, Carlos, I think it was Carlos who said that. Yeah,
and we're able to play, you know, one of my favorite songs that never entered my mind. You know, kind of let it roll, and we just use pictures of lovers, and you know, you just can flow with the ballad. You know, it's one of the sequences that in my career of everything I've ever done, I'm most proud of. I think it really works, and you really see, you know, the beauty of Miles Davis playing ballads, which we knew from the beginning, you know, we wanted to talk about as its own thing, because, you know, there's something special about Miles, especially in that mid-50s to mid-60s period, about those ballads.
Let's say right now he was alive and maybe in his very late 80s or something, and you approached him. It may be a case where it might actually be easier because of so much, as you described before, there's so much material to cull from, you know, that maybe this is a case where it's probably easier to make a documentary about him after he's no longer alive, because he seemed like he was fairly defensive and it might have been a difficult subject to follow while he was alive, you know, and to get his cooperation. I don't know. That sounds like I'm criticizing him, but I'm trying to, I don't know. You had so much material. The bigger challenge seemed like you were more about elimination. But do you think he would have been a difficult subject, were he alive, to make this film about him?
Yes, I think he would have been difficult. But yes, I think it would have been fascinating to make it, you know, with him, you know, alive. It would have been an incredible experience and a real honor. But would it have been difficult? Yeah. I think it would have been difficult. But probably the best compliment I ever got was from his son, Aaron, and his nephew, Vince, who said, you know, Miles would have loved this film.
Wow.
And so, you know, for me, that was the best compliment I could ever receive.
Of course. Sure. And watching it, you know, again, at the Maryland Film Festival, I was sitting with a couple of friends and we're watching it, you know, you felt so immersed in the film. It just carries you off between the music and the cinematography, the archive, all of it together. It's a transcendent experience watching the film. And I think you do bring Miles Davis back alive. I'm not articulating it very well, but you know what I'm saying. He's alive then while you're watching him. So, you know, it's a great job in that regard.
Well, thank you. I'm at a loss for words. That's such a wonderful compliment. Thank you so much.
Oh, thank you. I mean, you're welcome. Okay, here's another question. One sort of choice you made was to bring him back alive in a sense as the narrator of the film. So through this remarkable performance, I'm going to call it a performance because that's what it is, actor Carl Lumley, who not only sounds exactly like Miles Davis, but I'm sure most people come up to you and said, where was the audio? How did you get Miles Davis's audio? You know, I'm sure, because he's so spot on. But you picked the one actor who resembles him so incredibly. You could have had him actually play Miles Davis in a fictional version of the film.
Yeah, I think you know, we were really lucky. It was just, you know, one of those great, I think, you know, choices. You know, Carl just does an incredible job of reading, you know, and acting and performing Miles's words. I think it just adds something to the film, you know, because Miles was such a unique character. So the words are all Miles's, and they're all, you know, performed by Carl Lumley. When we premiered the film at the Sundance Film Festival, you know, people kept coming up to us and asking us if that was Miles, and saying, you know, the whole time I was sitting there wondering if that was Miles. So we put a card at the beginning of the film now that says, you know, all the words are performed by Carl Lumley, so that right. Going in, you're not sitting there, you know, not watching the film, but and not listening to the film.
Distracted,
just trying to,
in other words. Yeah, distracted.
Right. Yeah. So we put that in.
At the same time, it is sort of a choice that you made, which, and you say that this was all his writing. Was it his writing? He wrote these in a journal, or what?
They come from his autobiography, and they come from interviews that he did. You know, Miles was an interesting character because he, you know, pretty much for the large part of his life, he didn't do interviews, and you know, or very many interviews. Yeah. And then, you know, as we talk about when he makes his comeback, you know, in 81, you know, he becomes a different kind of Miles and does a bunch of interviews and TV shows and some other things. So there's interviews from Miles from that period. So we had a bunch of stuff to work with, you know, including his autobiography, and it's from those things that we pulled the track that we use in the film.
I see. So once again, it becomes a matter of elimination of so much material again out there between firsthand material, archive. I mean, there's just so much, the music itself. How do you construct this film before you begin it? you must, because otherwise this could be a 6-part, 12-hour documentary, no problem. Not even remotely. You could do hours on each chapter of his life, of his career, right? So how do you do that? You sit and you start to create a framework.
Yeah, I mean, I think one place you start is that we knew what we wanted to do was to make a 2-hour film. So we're like, we can do this in 2 hours, and we spent a lot of time talking and thinking about that. You know, when we hired the editor Lewis Erskine, who I've worked with a number of times, he was like, okay, how are you going to do 2 hours? But we said, you know, we can do this, and I think that for us, you know, there were certain points that we wanted to hit. You know, you got to talk about Kind of Blue. We wanted to talk about, you know, his time in France and elevated to the gallows and some other things there. Then things kind of take shape organically. You know, nobody knew that Frances would kind of come in and steal the show, but you know, she did. And so, wow, you know, we kind of let Frances go. And, you know, it's like, yeah, we like, you know, at some point we just said, okay, let's just take the reins off of her and like just let her, you know, because we felt like, well, wait a minute, you know, she's kind of taking the movie, but she's so incredible. She's so incredible that we just said, yes, okay, let's just let her go.
Oh, no, she's just amazing. She's entertaining and she's just a breath of fresh air. You know, it's because it's a fairly, let's face it, he's a very intense guy, very intense musician and subject. And for somebody, you know, his relationships as a result were very complicated, right? And so to witness Frances, who still has this incredible humor and particular way of explaining, you know, her relationship with him, it was perfect.
Yeah, I mean, I think the other thing is that you know, you subconsciously understand totally what Miles saw in her, you know, and what she provided.
True.
What she provided for Miles, you know, and it's very important, you know. Women were very important to Miles, you know, his relationship with women were very, very important. You know, although he was he could be awful, you know, for him they were incredibly important, and you see how, you know, he made some of his most incredible but also tender music, you know, when he was with Frances, a woman, yeah, who he truly loved.
Right. Well, again, the film is called Miles Davis, The Birth of the Cool. I've been talking to Stanley Nelson. And what is next? You're so prolific. Do you have just a list of ideas that you want to get to and you just sort of tick them off? And
I wish it was that. I wish it was that easy, but it's not. But
no, we know it's not.
We have,
yeah,
a bunch of things that we're working on. Most of them I can't really talk about at this moment, but we do have a bunch of things that we're working on. A big thing is we're starting a 4-part series on the Atlantic slave trade and kind of the economics of the Atlantic slave trade, which is a real challenge for us. So we're looking forward to that. But you know, the main thing right now is just getting Miles out there. So we're, you know, right. I mean, we start out in New York on the 23rd, but I think we go to 40 different cities, you know, after that, you know, like a week at a time, you know. So a lot of those places, I'm going to as many places as I can for the opening nights and stuff like that. So
that's a big commitment for a busy filmmaker like yourself, who is always working on a number of things at once and ambitious, to take the amount of time after the film has come out to travel with it. In a sense, you can't be doing other work while you're doing that.
I'm going to be reading on the plane, and because the openings are on Friday, Saturday, Sunday, you know, it's kind of my weekends.
Right.
But also, you know, to me, the best part, without a doubt, of filmmaking is to, once you finish the film, to see the film with an audience. That's the gravy. And so I'm gonna try to be at these screenings and sop up as much gravy as I possibly can.
Mm-hmm. I don't blame you. Well, I didn't get the benefit of the Q&A, but I do a podcast and I can invite you on every time you do a film. That's the beauty of it. So I get my gravy too, because I get to see it and I get to see it twice and I get to, you know, let it marinate. And then I get to actually talk to the filmmaker, which is like, you know, just a great perk, you know. So I'm grateful for having seen Miles Davis, Birth of the Cool, and for our conversation. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
Thank you. It's always a pleasure, and it's always a pleasure talking about that film. Thank you.
Alrighty. Take care.